This was a lady who had lost both her lower extremities. And we were able to get her to be able to walk as well with the prosthesis that were set up in her case. And look at the expression of the people who are the workers. The patients' expressions are that of happiness and achievement. And David, who's the one who's kneeling down, is looking at the expression because he's looking for any pain or any discomfort in any shape or form, because that's going to change how he's going to be using it. And then Paul, in the blue shirt, he's actually literally like a coach. He's just digging deep into the expressions and then see where is things are wrong. And then they're trained to look at what can be going imperfect in this situation. So, and then we had the nurses who were just trained for the rehab part, and they worked along with these patients. This was a young girl that we had seen earlier. She had lost her lower extremity. I can't say much, the picture says it all. This was another case. They were these twins, one of the twins had lost her lower extremity. So you got to see two beautiful expressions for one limb, and her sister was so excited. Paul has twin daughters, and so this was something very dear to him, and this was his moment where when Paul saw the twins, and he just worked whatever he could do to make sure that the children were able to get them. And again, another individual who was still healing from his fracture in his left arm, but he had lost his right lower extremity, and he was able to get a knee joint as well. The cost of an average limb of this capacity is in the $10,000 range. So this was all charitable work that was done by various groups of people who were able to make it happen. Again, this was a young boy who had lost his extremity. Now, after he had his leg, we saw him on the street. He was now doing business, if you will. The business is because your cell phones need to be charged, and there's no electricity. So if somebody gets a little bit of electricity, and they would charge your phone for getting some money. So he was in business now that he could walk. Out on the street and charging, and it's a simple thing that we take for granted. So many things, I cannot begin to say the things that we take for granted when you look at the story of this individual. There were children who had lost, and they were too young to even know what they had lost, and then there were children who had lost, but they knew what they had lost and what their responsibility was. This particular case was nice woman. She came. She had one daughter, and her neighbor's home, everything was destroyed except one child made it. And her own sister had died, and the entire family, and one of her daughters was left. So she just had three daughters. And her own daughter, when they came in, they had all illnesses, but her own daughter, who is the closest to me in the picture, she actually was so caring that she would not sit in a chair. She would want her sisters to sit in the chair. She wanted them to have the first evaluation. She was being generous, and it was, to me, it was like this 7-8-year-old girl has the understanding that she is going to be helpful and responsible for somebody else. And if you look at times in our household and in the U.S., sometimes people are not willing to share little things. And I was just looking at this kid. If God gave them the challenge, he also prepared them to be generous for each other. This child, when you look at him, he's no different than any other young 1-year-old or so. But if you look at his leg, it was actually burned, and there was no skin on it. And if not treated right, he was going to lose that leg. And this child had been like this for weeks. She had gone to the hospital, but nobody was willing to take care of him because they had bigger problems to deal with. So it was as simple as getting the right bandage and then setting the patient up for prevention of infection, and then hopefully when it's healed, getting the skin grafting done. So those little things that we would not be a problem in anywhere else, this was going to be a life-threatening condition for others. This I take a picture because it sort of gives me the an understanding that God has far better plans. So when I was collecting medications from all across, I went to our hospital, the Manchester Hospital, the ECHN, and they were very kind enough to donate a number of medications, antibiotics, and so on. And then they said, you know what, there's this Prozac could you use this? I said, you know what, let's take this. And I thought that people would use for depression, but it has to be done in a mechanism that you follow that along. So this woman had an underlying very difficult disease that she was dealing with from a psychiatric point of view, and she could not get any of that medicine. And it was just that very piece of medicine that was needed, and I had it, and about a day before I was coming over, and I just said, okay, I'll grab this. So it came from Manchester Hospital's shelf all the way to somebody in Haiti in a church sitting there, and so how things work out, it's sort of, God has bigger plans. The expression on some of the children's faces just gives you a glimpse. You could joke, you could dance, this child would not smile. This was a woman who came, and she had a lot of complaints. But her main complaint, end of the day, when you just dig down deep, was that she's on the street. She had no place to be. She had no cover, she had no place. And we had to actually sneak in a tent that we had brought. We had brought a number of tents. All the tents that we had brought with us, we actually gave it to the people. But her disease was that she had no cover, no shelter. But you have to hide the tent to give because it's a very big commodity there. So we have to sneak it out as if you were doing drugs or something. So we had to actually say, go over there, we're going to get this to you, run to the other side. And because people want the tents, because there are people, so many people on the streets at that time. This was one of the nurses, and I want to share this. Working from morning till afternoon, nonstop, high energy nurse, and the end of the day when you're saying, she said, I'm not feeling well. She has been living since the earthquake in a tent alone. And she lives in her tent, and you know what the tents look like. Gets up and then comes and works like she is rested, as better rested than anyone would ever be rested. The energy that she had was amazing. I said, you know what, I want to take your picture. And she said, why? And I said, because you're inspirational. So that's her. There's so many stories. I want to share this story as well. This is somebody at the American Airlines. So when I was coming back, I was, the way I had planned, I wanted to maximize my time in Haiti. And I said, I'm going to come in such a way, and it's not recommended, because I said, once I travel back, I'm going to go from the airport to the hospital and continue to work over here in the U.S. So it was not a good idea. So the flights had changed, the flights had changed because American Airlines had some problems at that time with one of the airplanes. So I could not come back, and I missed the connecting flight. And I was upset. I said, can you get me to New York? Can you get me to Boston? I will figure out a way to be at my workplace right away. And then they tried all options, and there was nothing else I could do. And I was just sad, and I had put my head down, and I was just looking down and upset. So she came over later, and then she put her hand over my shoulder, and she said, you know what? Things happen. And she said, look around you. Everybody's life has changed, and you're worried about your flight. And I said, you know what? I didn't learn in the last 5 days what I needed to learn. So things happen to every single person over there. And here I was complaining about missing a flight. And then she said that when the earthquake happened, she had walked out of a supermarket, and about 5 minutes later, the entire building collapsed and everybody died. And she was working with a smile, with the energy that we hardly see. So every moment you have people who are teaching you how to better live your life. And I needed a lot of that teaching. So then it comes to the point, what can we do about it?